tonight on the final open fight night of the season. A fired up locker room looking for a fight. On a night of open challenges, who will look to boost their momentum on the road to WrestleMania? After being shrouded in controversy over the last few months, the role model Andrew Kelly must put his light heavyweight title on the line. Who will answer the challenge and quite possibly walk out of the arena as champion? With a new look and attitude, Lydia took control of her narrative by winning the Women's Extreme Rumble. Now, the fiery redhead must look towards a locker room full of obstacles as she begins her path towards the seemingly unstoppable Akira Suzuki. A hero fallen from grace. A partner looking for revenge. AJ Drake and Ben Castello will do battle as Insanium looms in the shadows. The Texas star shined brighter than ever by winning the Men's Extreme Rumble and sealing a date with destiny with his former headhunter's brother turned bitter enemy. But will Stephen Jones' path to WrestleMania be met with an early end when he goes face to face with the Elite One, Matt Black? And it's back! After 4 years of inactivity, ECF's flagship program has returned. Welcome, once again, to Death Row.
You should see me in a crowd. I'm gonna run, there's nothing to hide. Watch me make them bow. One by, one by, one. One by, one by. You should see me in a crowd. Your silence is my favorite sound. Watch me make them bow. One by, one by, one. One by, one by, one. Count my cards, watch them fall. On a marble wall, I like the way they all scream.
Hello there, and man, does it feel good to be back. Welcome to the return episode of ECF Death Row, and it has been a long time coming. I am your host, as always, Jared Extreme. We are officially on the road to ECF WrestleMania 2. We already have a couple landmark matches announced for that show, but tonight it's big. It's the return of Open Fight Night. We got a lot of open challenges coming, but we also have this one. Ben Castello looks to get vengeance for his tag team partner as he takes on AJ Drake. And in our main event, the Texas star Stephen Jones is going to take on the Elite One, Matt Black, and what is sure to be a great main event here tonight. But here we go. Speak of the devil. Here comes the winner of this year's Extreme Rumble matchup, the Texas star himself, Stephen Jones, is here. You want to talk about the last time we had a Death Row episode? That was back in 2015. And the final Death Row ended with this man right here being carted off on a stretcher after a heinous attack by his former friend, former tag team partner, Jeff Garnett, the man that currently holds the Undisputed Championship that this man is gunning for right now. You know, like I mentioned, he's going to be going one-on-one with Garnett's associate later tonight, Matt Black, and Jones' first real roadblock in his title path. If Matt Black is able to put away the Texas star, Jones might be going home early. He might not be going to WrestleMania. I understand he's going to be speaking to everyone here in this building tonight. He's got a microphone in hand, and he's got something to say.
You know, I've been in this business for a long time now. I've been doing this for almost 2 decades here in this ring in ECF, fighting for you people. And I've had some great highs in my career. I've had some lows. This season has been quite a low point for me. I was on the shelf way longer than I expected. And a lot of that had to do with who was the man that put me on the shelf. A man I considered a brother, a man that I rode with, ride or die with this man. Of course, you all know what happened. We all know that that man showed his true colors in only the way he can. And I was gone for a while. And as I sat back, as I recovered, the slow rehabilitation process, I was focused on one thing and one thing only, and that's getting my revenge. And you might think, Stephen Jones, the Texas Star, you shouldn't seek revenge. Revenge isn't something a good person should seek. And to that I say, you are correct. At that point, I didn't know if I was a good person. I had thoughts, horrible, heinous, terrible thoughts that no good-willed individual should ever have of what I wanted to do to this individual. But I came back and I heard the reaction that I got in the Tokyo Dome, and it was a highlight of my career. I laid out that man and I put him on notice that I wanted the undisputed championship. And then I lost my opportunity to do so. So I said, I'm going to win that Extreme Rumble. And what did I do? I walked into the Barclays Center. I eliminated 6 individuals on the way, tying a record. And I am the winner of the Men's Extreme Rumble. And that's when I realized something. I'm not seeking revenge here, no. I am seeking my true destiny. And my destiny is to once again become undisputed champion. Now, I'm not the youngest guy in the locker room. It's been a long time since I've held a world championship. But the one thing I will not do is stop fighting. I have fought way too long and way too hard to give up at this point. So here I am going to say it. Headhunters may have been a thing, but that was years ago now, pal. It's you and me, Garnett, at WrestleMania. Your title is on the line, and you may have escaped. You may have beaten Phil Bradshaw. You may have defeated my friend, David Sandman. But you have never beaten me, because you knew you couldn't beat me, and that's why you decided to take me out when you did. You knew you needed to take the easy way out to get rid of me. There's not going to be an easy way out at WrestleMania. It's going to be you and me, a date with my destiny, and the Texas Star will shine brighter than ever before in Los Angeles when I once again become undisputed champion. And Jeff, prepare, train your ass off for this match, because not only is it my destiny to take that championship from you, but it is your destiny to wallow in your own defeat when you will lose.
Strong words from the Texas Star, but speak of the devil, here comes the Elite One. It's Matt Black coming out to interrupt the man that he will be going up one-on-one with later tonight in our main event. Man has had a very eventful 2020 so far, recently headlining Call All-Stars 12, was unsuccessful in gaining the Call All-Stars Championship, but here in ECF, he's been buddies with JG.
Everyone, it is the winner of the Royal Rumble. No, really, everyone, you need to look. It is Stephen Jones. And who gives a shit See, I didn't come out here to congratulate you. No. See, the Rumble may have not gone my way, but my story just doesn't end like that in ECF. See, just like everywhere else I have gone, every other promotion I have gone, my road is always paved in gold. Unlike yours, your road to WrestleMania, your road back to that championship ends tonight, because tonight in the main event, when we get all down to it, I am ending your road. The Elite One is your roadblock. Because tonight, in the center of that ring, 1, 2, 3, your dreams, your aspirations, this fairy tale ending that you see yourself having is nothing but a distant nightmare. Because when it comes all said and done, me and Garrett, we're going to hold all the gold in ECF, and there's not a damn thing anyone can do about it, including you. So tonight, I highly suggest you bring your A game, because the Elite One always brings his when it's time to be in the main event.
Matt Black saying that he is the true main event. And look at him, just disrespect for his opponent later tonight. Just shrugging off a former world champion here as Matt Black. You can never say that this man is short of confidence, short of arrogance. But he can definitely back it up in the ring. This is going to be one hell of a challenge for Steven Jones later tonight. But now we're actually about to kick off our first matchup of the evening. Our return match here on Death Row. And it is open fight night. And we're going to have our first open fight night, open challenge of the night. Here comes the Neon Devil himself, A-Pac Aries. Man, who's really hungry. He's really looking for a win here in ECF. Of course, recently capturing the AWF World Tag Team Championships as part of the Blade Runners. But here in ECF, A-Pac is, he's a singles guy. He's looking for some singles wins. It's been a little bit since he's won a singles match. You got to go back to, I believe, ECF Eve of Destruction, where he defeated a former Intercontinental Champion. But that was the last time I remember A-Pac having a one-on-one victory. And now he's looking to get that here tonight. But the man that's accepting his challenge, oh, here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Atomsk Galaxy. Because making his singles debut here on Death Row is Aether Atomsk. The Big Bang, the Guardian of the Atomsk Galaxy himself is here. Made his ECF debut back at Rumble or Riot 2 as a surprise entrant in the Extreme Rumble matchup. Made it quite far. He had a very big moment in that matchup where he caught Fisk mid-air with the Big Bang. Making a name for himself all across the car wrestling world, the current El Dorado Championship Wrestling World Heavyweight Champion. Now he's going to look to start his ECF singles career on a high note by taking out a veteran in this industry, perhaps, in A-Pac Aries, a former world champion over in New Dawn Pro. And A-Pac, the much taller man, starting with the kicks, but Aether firing back with some of his own. And the Neon Devil goes down for the first time. Big super kick by Aether, and a vicious German suplex. Just lifting a man much taller than him over his head, but only getting a two count. As this matchup continues, Aether now looking to fly. Big Hurricane Rana from the top. Aether again going for the pin. Is this going to be enough? You know, when you're watching an Aether Atomsk match, you know you're going to get a lot of high-paced action, a lot of high spots. Big spin kick there from Atomsk. It's a man that's going all across the pro wrestling scene, putting on showcase after showcase, whether it's in the AWF, SPW, 2K, DZW, ECW, the list goes on and on, but right now, A-Pac Aries is in the driver's seat. I said, A-Pac is a man that's really looking for a win here. He's got him up in a chicken wing position, dropping him head first into the top turnbuckle, and now A-Pac with the big forearm in the corner, following it up. Big Senton Atomico off the ropes. Again with these kicks. Big knee to the face. But Aether. Well, one for the chop block. But again, A-Pac just has too much of a height advantage. But Poison Rana from Aether. Some people have gone on and they've said they do not see the hype in this man. I'm telling you right now, this is a man that will be the future of this industry. Big forearm smash off the springboard. This could be it. One, two. But A-Pac Aries able to hang in here as this matchup continues on here at Death Row. So excited to be back on the road here in the States. Of course, we just had our homecoming show in Buffalo, New York. We had that big international tour lately, and we're excited to be here in Philadelphia tonight. Of course, we hope everyone is staying safe at home. Everyone here is following the proper guidelines and restrictions. A-Pac went for a frog splash, but Aether getting the knees up. Not typical of the Neon Devil to go for a high-flying move like that. But now Aether in control. Big drop kick to the back. Is he looking to finish this one off here? The quick end here for A-Pac, big shining wizard from Atomsk. And now Aether's looking to fly. And when he flies, it is a thing of beauty. Big 450 from the top rope. You want to talk about impressive. When A-Pac able to kick out. You want to talk about impressive? Look no further. All-Stars 12 very recently. This man was successful against SPW 2K's own Hypnosis, the world champion in several corners of the industry. But A-Pac there with the suplex neckbreaker. Is that going to be enough? No! Aether stays in this one, and that might have been A-Pac's last gap there. What is he going to do? He's hit all of his big moves here tonight. But oh my god, what a Spanish fly! By Aether, is that going to be it? No! A standing Spanish fly, seemingly out of nowhere, from Aether. And now what's Aether going for? For a second win, big spinning heel kick to the face. These fans are on their feet. For the Guardian of the Atomsk Galaxy, here we go, big bang! And is this going to be enough? It is! Aether Atomsk picking up his first win here in ECF. A massive showcase for such a young up-and-coming talent here in ECF. And I am very excited to see what he continues to do in the new era of Extreme. What a great match for this man. We are just getting started here. Open Fight Night 5, the last Open Fight Night of the season. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Death Row. It is open fight night, and I understand we're about to get another open challenge, and here comes another man looking to make a name for himself, making his singles debut here tonight is the King of the North, Scott McShannon. Made his debut after much hype at the Extreme Rumble, was not able to get his one-way ticket to WrestleMania 2 that night. But with a couple victories in a row, he may be looking to get an impressive spot on that night. And it all starts here tonight at Open Fight Night. Scott McShannon, accomplished around the world, has won several championships, has gone by many monikers. He's on a little bit of a renaissance with his career right now. Now he's made his way over to ECF. He's laying down the challenge.
ECF Nation. For those who don't know, by now, my name is Scott McShannon. And for anybody that missed it, at the Rumble or Riot, I was weighing over my head. I thought, for a second myself, that I was going to win it all. And I wasn't even close. That's my error of judgment. I own that mistake. And I'll give you credit where credit is due, KGD. You took me over the top rope. But the fact of the matter is, anything can happen in a Rumble. And I've been doing this for 16 long years. I realise that mistakes are made and how I redeem myself, bounce back and rectify those errors. That's down to me. And I'm going to put every single champion on notice. For 16 long years I've been doing this, is more than anybody, longer than anybody. And I maybe haven't lived up to the success that others have. But don't doubt for a second that I intend to change that. So, as the title says, it's open fight night, people! And I'm issuing a challenge right now to anybody in the bag that wants to take me on, as a matter of fact, so I can choke them out and solidify my place here in ECF. Come one, come all, bring them on all. Who's first? Who's next? Who can last?
Scott McShannon saying, bring it on, issuing a challenge. Oh, and this right here is interesting. Here's a man that's hungry, that's looking for a fight, for a spot, a shot, I should say, at redemption. The former hardcore champion, Brandon James. We have not seen Brandon James, the Outback Warrior, since his crushing loss at the Rumble to Mason Chronic, where he lost his hardcore championship. The belt that he's been fighting all season long to get his hands on. He finally had it. He had it for a little bit, and then he lost it just like that. And a very dominant performance from Chronic. Brandon James looking to turn the tides here tonight. Look at the look on the Outback Warrior's face. He is serious. There's no funny business here tonight. He's staring a hole in our cameras. You know that is meant for Scott McShannon. That's meant for Mason Chronic. That's meant for anyone that can get in the way of Brandon James' path to another championship. There are two men right now that do not currently have a guaranteed path to WrestleMania 2. That's why this matchup is so important. We are in the endgame of this season. And Brandon James immediately with the STO is taking down the King of the North. And what a impressive first challenge here for Scott McShannon. You want a big win, you're going to have to face a former champion to get it. And Brandon James right now is pissed with Scott McShannon with the lariat to the back of the head. And just tosses James to the other side of the ring. And a big stomp to the face as Scott McShannon starts his offensive battle tonight. Big forearms to the face. And again, just lifting James and hurling him across the ring. He has quite a bit of muscle mass on him. That's very impressive here for Scott McShannon. Big lariat by Brandon James as this back and forth affair continues. And Brandon James has to be looking at that loss to Chronic as a low point, perhaps an embarrassment in his career. He didn't have much of a chance in that matchup. Scott McShannon taking him out from the top rope. Brandon James wants a win to prove that he still has fight left in him. Scott McShannon wants a win to prove that he can hang with the best here in UCF. I mean, we've seen him have star-making performances recently. You want to look at Call All-Stars 12, the man that had Brandon Wolf's last ever professional wrestling matchup, was able to get the W that night, of course. We recently said goodbye to Brandon Wolf here in ECF. And our web match special in Mexico City. Scott McShannon, their very impressive reverse Alabama slam. But it's not enough to get the job done against the Outback Warrior, a man who seemingly has been facing or fighting for championships since he entered this company. Scott McShannon, if I know him, wants to have a very similar career, perhaps with a little bit more W's in his win-loss record. Brandon James with those fast and furious shots there. And oh, chop block! God, that might be it. Scott McShannon clutching at his knee. Brandon James now looking to fly. He's perched on the top rope. What is he thinking here? Brandon James shaking his head. Big crossbody. And is this going to be enough as the ref counts the pin? No. His shirt says, fight me, mate. All Brandon James wants is a fight any hour of the day, 7 days a week. And he's bringing those vicious strikes to Scott McShannon all over this ring. Beautiful World's Strongest Slam there from James. And now he's got him up. And he drops him. Gut-wrench powerbomb. Not enough, though. The King of North is still in this one. The Social Justice Warrior versus the Outback Warrior. Scott McShannon looking a little bit of damage in this matchup. He was clutching at his head just then. He was grabbing his knee earlier. Perhaps wasn't expecting the strikes of Brandon James, but he's still been able to hang in this matchup so far. Wait a minute, he's got him. I thought he had him in a victory roll, but now he's got some type of knee bar locked in. Scott McShannon, a touted submission specialist, trying to get the submission victory here in Philadelphia. Gonna try to make the Outback Warrior submit, but no. Brandon James still in it, but he's clutching at his leg. Definitely took a toll on him. And now Scott taking him down once again with the shoulder tackle. What does Scott have in store? He's going for another one of these. Oh dear God, reverse Alabama Salama. And that can't be good for Brandon James. No sir, it cannot. Shot to the back here by Scott McShannon, another lariat to the back of the head. And now Scott's gonna follow. What is this? He's got a dragon sleeper locked in. Brandon James caught in the submission hold. He's got nowhere to go. He's just trapped in this dragon sleeper. And wait a minute! It's already over! Brandon James just tapped out. He got stuck in the dragon sleeper and he couldn't escape. And as a result, Scott McShannon picks up the big W here tonight. And the downward trajectory of Brandon James continues here. The Scottish submission machine back in full force here tonight. A big victory here for Scott McShannon.
There was an idea to bring together a group of remarkable people to see if we could become something more.
So when they needed us, we could fight the battles
that they never could.
ECF Universe, the People's Champion is here, and I've been looking around, and I see all these people who want to be handed things. They don't want to work for things. You have the Kenyan Phoenix and the Shotgun Conspiracy people of the world, led by that nut Sean Walsh. I've been around him for far too long to know what his real agenda is, and they think that they should be given things. Phoenix is held up on, oh, I was the Hardcore Champion. Well, guess what? I used to be the Undisputed Champion. You don't see me complaining. I work hard to try and get another opportunity. Hell, we got Rush Hour who want to walk out of here, think they're above everyone else. Guys, I thought you were better than that. You gotta work for this. You gotta put it all in there. Dedicate yourself to getting back to this spot.
Oh. Dedicate yourself.
You know nothing about dedication. You know nothing about hard work. I'm sick and tired of you running around here claiming you deserve things. It's no more. Riley, you are mine.
We are back, and it is time for some women's action. As this woman says here, it is time to take control of your own personal narrative. The fiery British redhead herself is here. It's the winner of our second ever Women's Extreme Rumble. It is Lydia. Said at the top of the show in our opening package that she would be issuing an open challenge, and you've got to imagine that there are several hungry members of our women's locker room that are going to want a shot at the number one contender. She's got a date with Destiny, with Akira Suzuki at WrestleMania 2, the woman who just dominantly became the ECF Women's Champion at Rumble or Riot 2, a woman that's making a name for herself across the Call Wrestling Globe at events like Call All-Stars. But Lydia is no slouch. She's challenged for the women's title in the past. She's had a nice run as a member of the British Empire, but is that stable crumbled? She now is all alone. She's started her solo career very admirably with this Rumble win, but uh-oh. Oh, boy. Look who's answering the open challenge. She calls herself the Sister Savage. She made her ECF debut in that Women's Extreme Rumble. She is here. It is Beryl Bedlam. Was the sister of the Savage himself, Jamal Bedlam, the Baltimore Brickhouse, who also recently signed an ECF contract, is not here tonight as far as I'm aware, but it is open fight night, so you never know who's going to show up. Beryl was unsuccessful in winning that Women's Extreme Rumble, but she made it fairly far. Had a good showing. And she has made a name for herself across Call All-Stars, Virtual Wrestling United. Wherever she goes, it looks like success follows her. Like a serious aura surrounding her. And you look at Beryl Bedlam, the Sister Savage, and she just looks like someone you don't want to mess with. You don't want to piss off. I don't know if she's necessarily pissed off, but you gotta imagine that Beryl Bedlam saw the opportunity in front of her and with like nothing more than to take advantage of it, silence the number one contender, and perhaps they claim that she should be the one gunning for the Women's Championship at WrestleMania 2. Very excited to see this matchup, though, as the bell rings. We've already had two impressive matchups so far. Aether, Atomsk, Scott McShannon getting their first taste of victory here in ECF, and Beryl Bedlam, it might be the same after we're seeing this early explosive start from the Sister Savage. And look, she's got the advantage in height, in muscle mass. Oh, just taking Lydia out of the ring with that clothesline. Real quickly, I just want to touch on what we saw when we were coming back from commercial. Sean Riley was talking about, you know, his recent return, how he's got the shotgun conspiracy in his rear view. And who comes out and takes him out from behind? The Punisher, the Hero Killer, Fisk. Fisk has had a long list of targets lately. He is pissed off, and Lydia right now, her back's gotta be on fire after being powerbombed into that LED ring post. Gotta imagine Fisk and Riley will be coming to blows very soon. It's a matchup I'm very excited to potentially see down the line, but Lydia right now trying to fight back. I don't know how she's even standing after getting sent into that LED display. And now she's looking to fly. What is she thinking here? Lydia, big drop kick from the top rope. The fiery Brit's still in this thing. Let the intimidation factor of the Sister Savage get to her just yet. There's a reason she's made it this far. And now Lydia, clothesline after clothesline, and a third one. Now going for the cover. This could be it here. Only a one count, though. Beryl Bedlam still in this. Notice the kinesio tape on Beryl's shoulder there. I don't know if she's dealing with some kind of injury or just a fashion statement. Either way, shows that she's been around the block. She's been in her fair share of fights. Oh, what a forearm smash from the second rope by the Sister Savage. Showing that she can fly. Oh, and there's that big clothesline. Bedlam family has only been around the block for a couple years at this point. but they've been putting themselves on the top of the marquees everywhere they go. Gotta imagine they come here to ECF and they definitely are expecting the same results. Bedlam. Oh dear God. Oh no. Oh! Jesus! Pile driver dropping Linda straight on her head. Somehow, that's not the end of this matchup. Because Lydia's head spikes into the mat. Barrel now is just toying with her, it looks like. Taunting her. Oh, dear. Oh, no. Bedlam now. What is she thinking here? Oh, no. Look at... Oh, no, no, no. Don't powerbomb. No! Oh, my God! Look at this. Powerbombing her back first onto this ring apron. Look how Lydia's body just contorts as she falls to the ground, the apron, the hardest part of the ring. And now this Fez press with this furious flurry of punches from Barrel Bedlam. Lydia's already taken several vicious power bombs in this match. There's that pile driver. Somehow Lydia's back on her feet, but immediately gets taken back down. Is starting to become hard to watch here, folks. Barrel Bedlam, like I said earlier, just toying with Lydia. Lydia talks about controlling her own narrative. This is not the story she was thinking of when she took this match, that's for sure. She just falls to the ground after those 10 punches to the chest, those beats to the chest from Barrel Bedlam. She's just laughing at her. Lydia's slow to get up. So we might be seeing a countout victory here, folks. Well, Lydia now on one knee, somehow back on her feet, trying to get back in this one. Barrel knocking her straight back down. As the count continues, we're at a 5 count. And Barrel Bedlam staring through Lydia's soul. Lydia still back on her feet, slow to get up. Eight. And now at a count of 8, this is getting, we're getting to that danger zone territory. We're at a count of 9, Lydia is somehow able to get back into the ring. And she's trying to get back in this one. Big knee in the corner. Now looking to fly. Barrel Bedlam. And no to that one, slamming her off the top rope, and now it looks like the beatdown is going to continue. Oh no, oh my God. This has to be it, come on. No, no! What's the rule about Lydia? It is not easy to take her out, for her to stay down. That's why she won that rumble. Big headbutt. Now Lydia's going to try to get some fight back in her. She's firing up these fans. And Lydia. The ground and pound effort here. Going to do what she can to keep Barrel on the defensive. Big neck breaker. And she's screaming to the hills here. Screaming to the high heavens. Going to the top, what does she have? Big headbutt! Is this enough? Only a 2 count. What a great match we are seeing between these two fierce ladies here tonight. Now Lydia. Oh, here we go. This is vicious Lydia right here. Regal Plex. This is going to be enough. Is it? No! Now Barrel already back on her feet after being dropped on her head like that. I don't know how this woman does it. Oh no. Uppercut after uppercut in the corner. Looking for an uppercut train, perhaps. Another one. Back in the corner. Another one. And followed it up. Big drop kick. As the Sister Savage back in the driver's seat. Oh, no. Not again. For the love of God, no. Another pile driver here. And this has to be it. Come on. Stop the damn match. Lydia still will not quit. The amount of damage she's taken from Beryl Bedlam in this matchup, and she's still in there. Bedlam just saying, stay down. You've lost. But Lydia, hold on. Oh, here we go. What's she? Oh, here we go. DDT. And is that it? No. Lydia's signature DDT, not enough to keep the Sister Savage down. Bedlam, big knee to the face. I think maybe getting a little bit frustrated that Lydia is still in this matchup. Has her up for a powerbomb and drops her with another one. Not choosing to go for the pin, surprisingly. She's feeling confident here. And, oh, another headbutt. And goes for another German suplex. Another Sister Savage. And for another German suplex. What is she thinking here? Wait, hold on. Bedlam, vicious choke slam. Well, Lydia now, somehow trying to stay in this one. Look at the roll. Is this gonna be enough? One, two, and Lydia steals the victory. Somehow, some way, she is able to escape this one with the victory. Beryl Bedlam was just destroying her. But Lydia was able to outsmart the Sister Savage here tonight. What a great match. But you gotta imagine these two are gonna see each other in the ring again in the future. What a great match. But hold on a second. Kevin Cross now making his way to the ring. And he's grabbing a microphone. What the hell does the Intercontinental Champion have to say here tonight?
ECF, we are sorry for taking your time, but we have something to say. In fact, we were hoping to say this before our match with the Nightwolf, but that didn't happen. You see, we wanted to explain why we had that match, why we accepted that match. And it's quite simple. We're searching for something. We are searching for someone. And we thought maybe, just maybe, if the Nightwolf was going to face us, not the vessel of Brandon Wolf, but the Night Wolf itself, made its reappearance, maybe, just maybe, he would have had the strength to simply slay us. You see, we are looking for a God Killer, a God Slayer. And you might be wondering why, and it's quite simple. There's one universal law that Kevin Cross believes in, that we believe in, and it's simple. Every defeat either has two outcomes. You're either destroyed or you evolve. And we are an ever-evolving being. Every victory, every loss led us to this. Led us back to the Eldritch Horde. Led us back to what we are. But even though we hold a very precious prize here in ECF, doesn't mean we're done evolving. No, We know we can get stronger, we can get faster, we can get more destructive. We can only tap into that if we lose, if we fail. And that's what we are searching for. We want a God Slayer. We want to find our God Killer. And the Night Wolf might have been able to do it, but Brandon Wolf, as he is, even though we do respect you, Brandon Wolf, you were never strong enough to take us down. And now with that being said, our eyes are on you. You attack us after our match when we're at our weakest. And all you prove to us, Fixer, is that you will never be our God Slayer because you are weak. You're pathetic. Quite simply, you're a coward. But if you do want to take our prize away from us, we will welcome you into our temple with open arms. Go ahead, rest at our altar so we may take your body, your mind, and your spirit as sacrifice. But don't worry, coward, because every ritual leads to greater things. And maybe, just maybe, after we're through with you, you might have the strength to finally open your eyes.
Kevin Cross issuing the challenge for Ryan Carroll. Carroll in the front row. Kevin saying, get the hell in here, you coward. But the Passion Killer saying, not tonight. Of course.
You know, sometimes a king is thrown off of his throne. His subjects turn their backs against him, and he is forced to go into hiding until the time is right. Cape Fear ruled with an iron fist as I held the keys to the ECF kingdom. But we lost. We hit a low point. Our rule seemingly came to an end. And I needed to find myself. I needed to go away. I needed to find purpose again. And that's what I did. The Diego Montoya you knew this season had to be sacrificed. But alas, I have been reborn. And I have been reborn with a greater purpose, because another group seems to think that this is their kingdom, that they rule the roost. But they haven't met the Father of Fear just yet. Because I may have left, but I am still here, and this is still my kingdom, whether you like it or not, man. So I have been reborn with the greater purpose of purging Shotgun Conspiracy from ECF one by one until they all fall. We will get to El Dorado once again, and it starts tonight. When you, Scott Adams, fall to me. And once again, ECF, I have arrived.
The Father of Fear has made his return to take back his throne, as Cape Fear and the Shotgun Conspiracy are gonna go to war. And here comes the conspiracy themselves, flanked by Kenny Phoenix and Travis Sparks. Here comes the man that Montoya is gonna be going one-on-one with tonight, Scott Adams. The group then has been very down on their luck lately. It has not had the best track record since Day of the Black Sun, since Phoenix lost to Sean Riley, Scott Adams lost the Hardcore Championship. They didn't really picked up many wins. They were all unsuccessful at the Extreme Rumble. Scott Adams unsuccessful at ECF Homecoming. And that's where this war with Cape Fear started. They were beaten down on Sal Jones, Scott Adams' opponent that night. And Montoya made his return, stared down Phoenix. Phoenix walked away from that fight, but it seems to have started a faction war between these two groups. Shaka Conspiracy see themselves as the number one enemy, the number one faction in this company. Cape Fear and Diego Montoya believe that that crown is theirs and theirs alone. And Shaka Conspiracy are simply fake kings, imitators that stepped and sat down on his throne while he was away for a little while. Now we see the first test, the first battle in this war. Scott Adams is going to look to get back on the winning track, and that can only mean one thing. It means two things, actually. One, it means I shit my pants. And the other is that Cape Fear, as Diego Montoya always says, has arrived. A little while since we've seen the full group, but here we go. Ryan Andros on the right, Enigma on the left. And of course, front and center, lantern in hand, the father of fear is back! It's been a long time since we've seen Diego Montoya in singles action. And his return to Death Row. Cape Fear really kicked off in its current form on our last few editions of the original ECF Death Row. Now looking to go right back to where things were. Now Cape Fear is another faction that, you know, in the absence of Montoya, were struggling to find an identity, struggling to get on that winning track record. Enigma and Andros fell short on several occasions to the Black Lotus. Aliza Montoya lost her title to Akira Suzuki. We had Steven Syntax get destroyed by Mason Chronic. We haven't seen him since. So now we're just down to Aliza Montoya and these three right here. The original disciple, Ryan Andros, muscle of the group Enigma, and of course, their leader, Diego Montoya. With Montoya as a member of this group and leading them once again, I feel like they're going to go back to the land of prominence. We saw them at the beginning of the season where they were just dominating. They had the tag titles at one point. They challenged for the Undisputed Championship. They were undisputedly the top group in this company. Some people now claim that Shaka Conspiracy has that crown. Montoya clearly taking offense, and look at those strikes. That is unlike anything we've seen offensively from Diego Montoya in this company. In his time away, perhaps Montoya looking to change up his arsenal a little bit. And now Montoya, oh my God! Tope Khan, hello from Diego Montoya. Not a man that we used to see fly like this and have this type of speed and agility. Looks like he's slimmed down a little bit. And he's changed up his offense. And I gotta imagine Scott Adams was not expecting this. This is a whole new Diego Montoya we are seeing tonight. As Andros and Enigma staring down with the Shaka Conspiracy on the other side of the ring. Montoya, hold on, Scott Adams now, trying to get back in this matchup. Vicious kicks to the chest. And make it difficult for Montoya to breathe. Now, Adams, backbreaker there from the former Hardcore Champion. Scott Adams, big kick. going to the top rope. Scott Adams looking to fly here. And Scott misses on the elbow drop. This is not good for Scott. Oh my God, black mask kick from Montoya, but Scott Adams was able to grab onto the rope. And now Kenyon Phoenix having a war of words with Diego Montoya, the two leaders of their groups, squaring off in a verbal battle. Now Scott has big stunner. And this could be it right here. Is this back to the wins for Shaq and Conspiracy? No. Right off the bat, Scott with the stunner, Montoya with that black mask. Well, I don't even think we're 2 minutes into this matchup. Now Scott, not enough, trying to sneak the victory. Now Scott, big clothesline in the corner. And Enigma, now going after Scott, the two big men of the groups, and a German suplex from Montoya, taking advantage of the carnage. And Montoya looking to fly. What is he thinking here? Diego Montoya. Oh, spinning elbow from the top rope. And again, it looks like Montoya is going at it with Kenyon Phoenix. This could be what Scott Adams needs here. Got him up and drops him with the dragon suplex. Yet no, not enough to put away Diego Montoya. Big knee to the face. Scott Adams looking at Cape Fear with contempt. These two factions do not like each other in the slightest. Kick after kick after kick in the corner. Again, these new speed, these new martial arts oriented strikes, these high flying moves. Very different offense from Montoya here tonight, but this, he's going back to an old favorite. Montoya has him up and drops him with the muscle buster. And again, Phoenix getting on the rope. At what point does the referee send the Shotgun Conspiracy to the back? He might not need to. Montoya now, he's got him! Drops him, he calls that the Twisted Sister. Is that gonna be enough? And that's it. Montoya pulled out a whole lot of new tricks tonight, and it was enough to get him the victory as Cape Fear gets the first victory in this faction war. But you gotta imagine that it is not over between these groups. But this is something this group has needed for a while, a victory, and a dominant one at that. The group definitely is stronger when Diego Montoya is a part of it. We have not seen in quite some time. Hold on a second. I see someone on the ramp.
Damn it. Oh, my God. Scott, what do you want? Do you want me to come out in front of all these people and bawl my eyes out? Because somebody somewhere has to express some damn emotion for whatever the hell that was in the ring. That was pathetic. You should be ashamed of yourself. You're supposed to be the muscle of the damn Shotgun Conspiracy, the most destructive force here in ECF. Scott, I've seen you powerbomb people on the steel steps multiple times just because you wanted to. And now you're out here losing to Diego Montoya and you don't even care. It's just another day at work for you. It means nothing. So you want some honesty, Scott? If it doesn't mean anything to you, maybe you should pack your bags and retire. But you know what? The problem only starts with Scott Adams. You know, see, Phoenix, Travis Sparks, you guys aren't innocent either. For the past few months, you guys have been coming out here and embarrassing me. No, even worse, you've been embarrassing yourselves. We're supposed to be the most dominant force here in ECF. That's why I picked you three to be in the shotgun conspiracy, because I know what you can be. But then you come out here and you give performances like this. I'm sitting on commentary during the Extreme Rumble and you guys are tossed out in mere minutes. Pathetic. Travis, you have all the gifts, all the talent in the world. If you want it, you can go for it. But maybe you're just too damn complacent, and when a challenge comes your way, you just don't want to reach for it. And then Phoenix, Phoenix. You know, I went way out of my way to try to pull you into the shotgun conspiracy because I saw something that everyone else didn't see. Everyone told me, they told me, Phoenix, that I was wasting my time, that you were a lazy, no good piece of garbage. And you know, maybe they were right. Maybe I did waste my time going after you. Maybe you should join Scott in retirement if this is the kind of work that you're proud of. So to all three of you, if you don't care anymore, if this means nothing to you and you don't care about embarrassing yourselves, please don't let the door hit your ass on the way out. But if this was the slap in the face that you needed to turn everything around, well, then I'm here to help you out. See, because I'm sick and tired of losing this war to Cape Fear. Cape Fear up and disappears. They come back and they think that they are the most dominant force in ECF. No. They're wrong. We are. The Shotgun Conspiracy runs this show. And you know what? Maybe the Shotgun Conspiracy needs something new. Needs some new energy to boost morale. Maybe we need someone who's willing to take on any challenge. I've never seen anyone more ambitious than this individual. Maybe his energy will rub off on all of you. So I've decided that the Shotgun Conspiracy has one more recruit. So Cape Fear, I'd love to introduce you to the King.
Oh, wait a minute. Oh boy. Sean Walsh bringing in the big guns here. It's the King. Bobby Mitchell is the newest member of Shotgun Conspiracy. And if they needed something to kick this group in the ass, knock some sense into them, this is what they need. Bobby Mitchell came in at number 28 in the Extreme Rumble matchup, made it to the final three. Was not able to get the victory that night, but he's here. He's on death row. And Sean Walsh bringing him in to the Shotgun Conspiracy. The group that many have argued needed some fresh blood. Bobby Mitchell is the Shotgun Conspiracy's answer. And now Mitchell in the ring. And a super kick to Ryan Andros. And now Enigma coming in defense of his stablemates. Enigma looking to ruin Bobby Mitchell's party early. And hold on, Mitchell has the big man up and slaps him with a modified Death Valley driver of some kind. And Bobby again, cross-country kick. Taking out two members of Cape Fear in one go. And now Montoya's in the ring. And this is a fight we've all wanted to see for quite some time. Oh! A big shot by Montoya.
and Bobby... Oh, hold on. Another cross-country kick. And Bobby Mitchell has laid out all three members of Cape Fear by himself. You want to win this war against Cape Fear? This is how you do it. You bring in someone like Bobby Mitchell. And hold on a second. Oh, magic killer. And Diego Montoya has been completely laid out. Shotgun Conspiracy strikes back here tonight. And now with Bobby Mitchell in the ranks, this group, it looks scarier than ever. But you gotta know that this war with Cape Fear is not over in the slightest.
When you're Mason Chronic, you gotta watch your back. John Blackos tried to take me out in the Elimination Chamber.
You're a fat bitch, Chronic.
And that bitch been Hopkins.
It's a Hopkins thing. You wouldn't understand.
Came after me backstage. JMI tried to poison me with his vegetables and catering.
Chronic, you need to eat healthier. You're getting too thick. You need to stop eating red meat and eat broccolini.
But no matter what they do, no matter how hard they try, there is nothing and no one that can stop me.
You and me, bra and panties match right now.
I win.
No, Chronic, we all win on the AWF Network.
Well, here's a man that has some explaining to do, that's for sure. The role model, the light heavyweight champion, has entered the building, perhaps with more controversy surrounding him than ever before. With controversy. Apparently comes a title defense. You know, Andrew Kelly, according to our commissioner, has to put the light heavyweight championship on the line here tonight. We got here because he took the easy way out against John Blackos at the Rumble, used a low blow to help him retain the championship. Chris Simmons said you need to put this title on the line, and Andrew Kelly, in retaliation, just brutally attacked Chris Simmons at the end of our homecoming show. It was just a vicious beatdown. I understand Chris Simmons is not able to be here tonight. Now the role model grabbing a microphone. Okay, whoever
is about to come out and challenge me for this title, I have a few things I want to get off my chest first. And it's not going to be in one of those heavily edited, fancy, award-winning public service announcements that the role model graces to you every single week. No, 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 no. This is coming straight from the heart because I have a bone to pick with that piece of shit commissioner known as Chris Simmons. Who, Chris, you might be watching this from a hospital. So hello if you're watching this right now and you're listening to what I have to say. It is an absolute travesty that I need to defend this light heavyweight championship here tonight. I've been the champion since Prime Destruction, and what have I brought this company? Views, ratings, all-stars clicks, attention, something that no other champion has ever brought this company. I'm looking at you, Brandon Wolf. How's the retirement home treating you? I hope that baseball bat from that dumbass Ryan Carroll felt great. But no, no, no. Now I'm out here because I apparently, according to the commissioner, bent the rules and quote-unquote cheated to retain my light heavyweight championship at Rumble or Riot 2. Look back at the footage. I want to see where the cheating is. Because the referee didn't see anything, which means everything was perfectly legal. I beat John Blackos. That's all you need to know. If you look in the record books, you'll see a W next to Andrew Kelly and a big old fat L next to John Blackos, because that's all he's good at, is catching those L's. I've beaten everyone in front of me, but this commissioner all season likes to throw roadblock after roadblock in front of me because he's got a hard-on for me. He wants to see me fail. Do I need to remind you earlier in the season when he first brought me in? And in my third match, what does he say? If you don't win this match, you will never challenge for a title again? In my third match, everything I've had to deal with, being thrown to the curb with every other promotion I've ever been in, coming here, proving them wrong, becoming the role model, winning the light heavyweight championship, and the commissioner never treats me with respect. So do you want to know why I attacked him at homecoming? Why wouldn't I? Every single time I do something to just, I throw him a bone. I give him, you know, a good thing to pop a rating. And he throws me into bullshit defenses like this. So yes, I hope every single one of those chair shots hurt. I hope everything I did to you, Simmons, hurt. Because if you cross me again, if you get in my way again, it's going to be the last thing you ever do. I hope you understand that right now. So, with that said, I guess I have to defend this championship right now. So whoever wants to challenge the role model, the greatest light heavyweight champion that this company has ever seen, come on out and I'll treat you like Chris Simmons. In other words, I'll treat you like my fucking bitch. Jesus, there's children watching this show. Watch your goddamn language, man. Hold on. Okay, well, we know it's an open challenge. Oh, this is interesting. The former one half of Bad Dreams, Sean Kingsley. He calls himself the beacon of hope of ECF, the pride of London. Just a matter of time until he re-began his solo career. Of course, Bad Dreams, according to that stipulation at Rumble, Riot 2 was forced to go their own separate ways. We saw his partner, or his former partner, I should say, Sal Jones, start his singles career at Homecoming with an impressive victory over Scott Adams. Now Sean Kingsley looking to perhaps go the same way, but also as a result earn it another championship. A former ECF tag team champion, a former European champion back when that belt was still active in our early seasons. but Andrew Kelly has held this light heavyweight title since ECF Pride and Destruction. He's beaten men like Brandon Wolf, men like KGD, men like John Blackos while defending this championship. He is no joke, and as much as I despise the man, think he's an arrogant, pompous fool, the furthest thing from a role model, he can get it done in the ring, but sometimes he can use nefarious means to do so. So Kingsley has to look out for that. I do know, though, that according to the commissioner, and this was added on after Kelly's vicious assault, that if Andrew Kelly gets himself disqualified or counted out in this matchup, he will lose the light heavyweight championship. So Kelly versus Kingsley, here we go. Light heavyweight title on the line here at open fight. And big discus elbow from Sean Kingsley to start things off. Again, the Beacon is no joke. One of the best technical wrestlers we have here in the company. Just because he's been a part of a tag team for a little while doesn't mean he can't get the job done. And look at him taking these drop kicks to the champion right off the bat. Things like dragons through, taking Andrew Kelly off his feet. But Kelly rolling out of the ring, looking for an early breather. Is this fat bastard already gassed? Big kick there from the role model. Again, just that heinous assault that Andrew Kelly gave to our commissioner is just disgusting. We've just witnessed Chris Simmons make his return from retirement unsuccessful against Rush Hour, and then he was just greeted with chair shot after chair shot from this man right here. And we do know that he's currently being treated in a local hospital. Andrew Kelly, big leg drop off the top rope, not enough. Kingsley able to kick out, but the role model was not pleased one bit. Kingsley trying to get back in this one. Matchup still in its early stages. By no means is Kingsley out of it just yet. Another dragon screw, and just whipping his leg into the canvas. And now Kingsley up top, big elbow drop. Like the purple and green, I gotta say. It's a different look here tonight for Sean Kingsley. So used to seeing him in those Bad Dreams colors as of late. This is a man on his own now. Like I said, we saw his former partner have a good, promising start to his renewed singles career. And I have full confidence that both of those men will do great things on their own. Despite the premature end of their team, Kingsley has Kelly now locked in his guillotine choke. Looking to potentially make him submit. AK, oh dear God, basement drop kick. Again, I mentioned former European champion. That belt, when it was around, was unified with the Intercontinental Championship that we currently see held by Kevin Cross. Kingsley had that championship for almost a full season. Hold on a second. Not enough. And the man that beat him for it was a Punisher, Fisk. So if a man like Fisk was the only one that was able to take a belt off of Kingsley, Andrew Kelly sure is a big challenge again. In the corner, I'd like to remind you that coming up next, we have this brutal match that I am very much looking forward to. Ben Castello, AJ Drake going at it. The Sins have imploded. Ben Castello looking to get revenge for his tag team partner Insanio as he takes on Insanio's deranged brother, AJ Drake, the fallen hero. That is going to be a good one here on a return episode of Death Row. Now Kingsley, hold on. Going for the repeated stomps to the chest of our light heavyweight champion. And now Kingsley setting him up. Going for a super kick. And this could be it here. Is this enough? No! Not enough to get Kingsley some singles gold. And now, oh, another spinning heel kick from Andrew Kelly. And the role model is back in control here at Open Fight Night. Going off the springboard into an uppercut. Kelly slow to get up, dropped to one knee there. Perhaps this match taking a bigger toll on him than he hoped to admit. Big danger of losing the championship to John Blackos in Brooklyn. Of course, he pulled a low blow out of his hat while the referee was down. He was able to walk out as champion. Andrew Kelly just has this wonderful gift of pissing off just about everyone. What a side effect on the outside. That could be a difference maker here. Seems like him and Simmons have been going at it all season. As Kelly mentioned in his promo, in his early days here in ECF, his first couple of months, he pissed Simmons off to the point where Simmons threatened to never again let him challenge for a championship if he was unable to win a matchup. And that's kind of where this beef started between them. Oh, no. Oh, no. Dear God, no. Oh, neutralizer through the announce table. Take another look at this one. Move that's put away opponent after opponent in Kelly's championship run so far. Going on the longest reign anyone has had with that championship here in ECF. May have already broken that record. Kingsley now slow to get on his feet. Back in the ring. And Kelly taking some issue with the referee, but now Kingsley with the bulldog. And it looks as though the role model is donning a bit of a crimson mask here. Kingsley setting him up. Missed on the union knee. And another basement drop kick from Andrew Kelly. And now, oh dear God. Oh, last shot. Is this enough here? Only a two count. Good Lord, this one continues. Kingsley back on his feet. Another drop kick here from the champion. Great back and forth matchup we've seen so far. Kelly looking to do anything he can to retain this championship. Oh! Wrecking ball. Hurricane Rana here. Take another look at this one. He's taking Kingsley out on the outside. Pulling out all the big guns here is the role model. And now he's got him. Oh, King. Oh. It's like Kelly may have injured his back at some point. He buckled there while carrying Kingsley across the ring. Now Sean Kingsley taking advantage of this. He's thinking. He's on the top, looking to fly. Now Kingsley drops him with the axe handle. And now Kelly Eaton, big healthy serving of that ring post. Part of your balanced breakfast. Kingsley! Oh! Springboard crossbody! A corkscrew crossbody! I don't know if he connected with all of it. But Andrew Kelly trying to get back into this one, trying to get back in this matchup. Now Kingsley working on the arm, trying to get that submission victory. Now what's the beacon thinking here? Oh, again! With that big kick from Andrew Kelly. Now he has him in the corner. It's the champ going for here. He's got him perched up on the top rope. No. There we go. Andrew Kelly with the superplex. Big superplex from the champion. And now what is AK looking for? He's just wrenching that head and neck back and forth. Dropping the elbow. And the referee telling him to back off. They're looking to see if Kingsley is hurt. This match may need to end early. Kingsley has suffered an injury, but Andrew Kelly doesn't care. He's continuing the assault. And now, looking on the leg of Sean Kingsley. Perhaps we cannot connect with that union knee that he tried to hit earlier on in this matchup. Kelly now, side effect again. And this might be it too. Not enough. Kelly looking to see what he can do to win. Oh, hold on a second. I thought he wasn't here, but the commissioner is in the building. Chris Simmons is on the ramp, and he's got a chair, and Andrew Kelly is telling him to bring it. And oh, and Kingsley now taking advantage of the distraction. Hold on, kick there. Sean Kingsley got him. He drops him! Holy crap, what a destroyer! Is this gonna be enough? And it is! We have a new light heavyweight champion. He calls that the London Fog, and that was enough to get him the victory tonight. And our commissioner may have played a little bit of a role in it. But the era of the role model has come to an end, and the era of Sean Kingsley has just begun. What a moment here for a return episode of Death Row. Takes more than ears to hear it, takes more than tears to feel it, takes more than pain to heal it, regain your spirit. Don't take your time, gotta face your grind, gotta take your mind and clear it. No time to kill, you got the skills behind the wheel, not steer it. I tried being lazy, it really wasn't me, cause a man that doesn't work, that's a man that doesn't eat. And I can see my future obstacles preparing their defeat, cause I'm standing in the mirror, but I'm staring at a beast. Can't face defeat and I can't be weak because the struggle is tough. Gotta bring that heat, get back to your feet and say enough is enough. See, I fell to the ground, looked around and I found it. I was down on my luck, so I stepped my game, my pride, my confidence, and stamina up. Now I'm smashing all my foes, I'm passing all my foes. I got passion and it shows. Go, go, get you, reach my goals. You came to see greatness, then pass me the mic. This is what my mama told me when I asked for advice. Mama said, it's a pill for oddities, a stranger crisis. Ain't never wanna be so weird in the novelties. Don't ever change, we wanted everything, wanted everything. Stay up on that rise, stay up on that rise, and never come down. Oh, stay up on that rise, stay up on that rise, and never come down. Mama said, don't give up, it's a little complicated. All tied up, no more love, and I hate to see you waiting. They say it's all been done, but they haven't seen the best of me. So I got one.
Shooting for the stars when I couldn't make a killing. Didn't have a dime, but I always had a vision. Always had high, high hope.
You see, my issue that I have with Insanio Lucas Drake, the man formerly known as my brother, goes way deeper than just a couple wrestling matches. It goes way deeper than just him getting involved where he doesn't need to get involved and ruining every chance I have. No, 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 no. This goes back to the beginning. This goes back to when we were kids. When I had to be the younger of two brothers going up. When I had to deal with day after day, month after month, week after week, year after year, I have to deal with this motherfucker getting every single preferential treatment in the book.
with family, with friends, at school, at gatherings. Everywhere I went, I always played second fiddle to the picture-perfect Lucas Drake. He can do no wrong. Getting passed over on everything because of this man. Getting awarded awards, scholarships that I missed out on because of this man. Going to school, having a crush on a girl, wanting to ask her out, spending nights, weeks, having sleepless nights, trying to muster up the courage to ask this girl out. And I go to school with roses in my hand, and the next day I see him holding her in his arms. He knew what he was doing. Every single thing with him was a constant game of trying to one-up me. And of course, he'll deny it. He'll claim he was a great brother. He was so supportive of little AJ, but everything was done to spite me. So when I finally made it here to ECF, there was the one thing that I could take pride in, being the undisputed best. There was no second fiddle when I arrived here. I came here to prove that I will not stay in his shadow any longer. I had big shoes to fill. He had already won world championships, but I stepped in and I proved I was the best damn in-ring performer to ever step foot into this company. I earned that amazing moniker from day one. The talk was always on me, not on him, and it ate at him for years and years and years, and that's why he's always hated me. That's why it is his fault. When I say it is your fault, Luke, I mean that with every ounce in my body. Over these next few weeks, I'm going to prove that it is your fault. And you can sit here and cry and wonder what you ever did to deserve such hateful words being spewed by your younger brother that you thought you did so much to protect and to help and nurture him and mentor him and bring him to the promised land. All you did was fuel the fire that is going to engulf you at WrestleMania. Because we're going to end this, and it is not going to be a good old wrestling match so you can apply a rest hold to me for 5 minutes and then shake hands at the end. No, you're going to lay in your own grave. And it is your fault. Just remember that. It'll be no holds barred in Los Angeles. I'm going to eviscerate you. I'm going to make you wish you were never born. I'm going to make sure you hurt every single day until that matchup. And it starts tonight when I destroy Ben Castello in the ring. Because that's a man, your partner that you valued more than your own brother. And he's going to pay tonight. And just remember, Lucas, all of it is your fault.
Hold on a second.
Oh! Oh no!
We were just about to go to our next matchup, but Andrew Kelly has just burst into Chris Simmons' office and is beating him down with a steel chair and, oh dear God, no, no, no! Neutralizer on the floor! Clearly, just seething over the fact that he is no longer light heavyweight champion. Andrew Kelly feels it's another slight against the commissioner. This man has held championship gold for almost half of the season. Now he feels almost naked without that championship, and just this, we've already seen one vicious assault of Chris Simmons at the hands of this man. Now we're seeing another one here, and this doesn't look good for the commissioner. Now someone get out here and put a stop to this. Dear God, no, 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 no. Oh, no.
Andrew Kelly, you sick son of a bitch. But allow me to just recompose myself, because we've got a lot to talk about in this matchup. Perhaps the most personal match on this card tonight. Here it comes. The first ever Triple Crown champion in ECF history. The Test. Ben Castello. One half of the Sins. And the Sins won't stay down. There's a lot that has transpired between the Sins and AJ Drake. AJ Drake, the brother of Ben Castello's partner, Insanio, also known as Lucas Drake. Recently we saw this brotherhood implode. AJ Drake has snapped. We just heard from him. Oh, hold on a second. Speak of the devil. Here comes the fallen hero himself. And he's taking out Ben Castello on the ramp. Not even waiting until this match begins to start this vicious assault. AJ Drake claiming that every single thing that has happened in his life that he views as a negative piece of his life has been Insanio's fault. With Ben Castello, oh, hold on, Ben Castello with the backdrop and a big uppercut. He's not taking this without a fight. He wants to fight back, as we saw at Homecoming, just attacking AJ Drake with these kendo sticks. And Castello with the knee drop from the top rope. As we saw, AJ Drake, he views Ben Castello as a man that his own brother viewed as more of a brother than himself. AJ Drake clearly has gotten to him psychologically over the years. Castello powerbombs him into the guardrail. And the Test is seeing red right now. He is furious as he's throwing AJ Drake all around this arena. Ben Castello views Insanio as family. With AJ Drake, blood is thicker than water. And that's why he feels so offended, so betrayed, that all of these so-called wrongdoings that Insanio has done him over the years. Big boot to the face from Ben Castello as this matchup has now begun. Quite funny that AJ Drake attacked the Test before this match began, looking to get the advantage, but right now, AJ Drake now just getting that advantage he had hoped for. Just these stops, just stomping on the limbs of Ben Castello. This is a deranged individual. This is not the man that we have seen over the years, the former two-time ECF Undisputed Champion. This is a whole different man. Oh, big drop kick by the fallen hero. It just doesn't resemble any AJ Drake I've ever known. Just twisting the arm of Ben Castello, and now looking to choke him out with this modified camel clutch. The knee just digging straight into Ben Costello's back. Look what it says on the back of his tights. I'm deranged. No shit, buddy. Big uppercut, though, from Ben Castello as he tries to get back in this matchup. We just saw AJ Drake in his promo issue a challenge. AJ Drake versus Insanio. We know those two will be going at it at WrestleMania 2, but AJ Drake looking to up the stakes. He wants to make it no holds barred. But Ben Castello now, with those triple gut wrench suplexes, wants to put an end to that right then and there. But according to AJ Drake, he wants this match to be the last match of the Test career. Brutal as this match is going to be, we know our main event is going to be just as special. Steven Jones will be going one-on-one with Matt Black. You have that to look forward to, as our open Fight Night 5 main event. And now Ben Castello drops him with the suplex. This is, we haven't seen Ben Castello in a one-on-one match, I believe, since the Gold Rush tournament. Normally, Ben Castello is very accomplished as a singles wrestler. Like I mentioned, him and Jet Fusion are the only two Triple Crown champions we have in our YouTube era. But he has really taken a backseat to singles action this season, mainly focusing on teams. This might be where it comes to bite him, because now AJ Drake has him right where he wants him. One hero now from one of the top rope, and Drake, what's he thinking? AJ Drake, five-star frog splash to the outside. And you know he has loved to use that move to retain championships in the past. And now AJ, go! Back first into that guardrail. Looking to bring some pain, looking to bring some hurt to Ben Castello here tonight. AJ Drake back in the ring. Ben Castello staring him down. And now Ben looking to perhaps. Oh, hold on. Oh! Big elbow to the face from the top rope. The strikes and the uppercuts of Ben Castello are no joke. But AJ Drake now with the flying forearm. And Ben Castello is busted open. Caused some difficulty with his vision. All that blood pouring down his face. Big arm drag there from AJ Drake, and another forearm to the face, looking to potentially open up that cut a bit more. What's AJ thinking here? Going for another five star, but no! Castello able to get the knees up, and he calls it up with that pop-up uppercut. And this could be it. One, two, is it enough? No! Still got a whole lot of match left in these two. Just look how angry Ben Castello is right now. This is a man that he viewed as family. Oh, and he drops him with the TKO. The test grade. Take another look at that one. Has won him championships on the grandest stage before, but it's not enough to put away AJ Drake here tonight in Philadelphia. Costello arguing with the referee, saying that was free. Like at WrestleMania 1, that's what he used to capture the Intercontinental Championship. Wasn't enough to win this one tonight. Got him up for a military press into a gut buster. Sims have been a very accomplished tag team with one tag title gold this season. This is why Castello, this is why this means so much to him. He's fighting for the honor of his best friend, his tag team partner, but AJ Drake may have just went low there. And a discus lariat to get him back in control of this matchup. I'm not entirely sure if that was 100% a low blow, but it sure didn't look pretty to me from where I'm sitting. And no, dear God, no, back suplex on the apron by AJ Drake. And now AJ looking to maybe put an end to things early. Have in store for Castello right now. The bullet point here, perhaps, in this matchup. Slap to the chest. AJ Drake looking to fly. Big tope suicida. And let's take another look at that one. Just his whole body going right into Ben Castello like an incoming missile. Oh, Arabian moonsault. Marcus Lariat. As AJ Drake right now is in full control. Perhaps going for the amazing clash on the outside, but no, Ben Castello countering it. And a big boot to the face. As Castello looks to get this match back in his hands and put away the fallen hero tonight, perhaps for good. Doing. Hold on. AJ Drake perhaps going for a swing. But he's back on his feet already. Just the determination he has to take out anyone that reminds him of his brother and the psychological pain that he's gone through over the years. Massive spear. That's not enough. You know, if I were AJ Drake, I would walk away. I would get the help I need. Clearly that there are deeper issues here than what goes on in a wrestling ring. But in AJ Drake's mind, this is the only cure he has, is to put away these demons in this ring. But I just think it's sickening the way he's going about it. Five-star frog splash for the second time in this matchup. But he's not going for the pin. Oh, a leg drop. AJ Drake, another leg drop. This might be it. Off the five-star on those leg drops, but not enough. As this one continues on here. And oh, what the hell? He's taking apart the turnbuckle. He's taking... Referee, there's an exposed turnbuckle there. Oh, and Ben Castello goes face first into the turnbuckle. Already busted open from earlier. This does not seem good for the test. Oh no, execute order 66. Not looking good, and that's it. Son of a bitch. The fallen hero claims another victim here tonight. And he is one step closer. His no hold barred encounter with his own brother to perhaps end the career of Insanio in Los Angeles. I can't believe what this man has become. Further and further into the darkness every single week. It was an impressive matchup. AJ Drake getting the victory, but it doesn't look like he's finished. Just look at the hatred that is spewing just from that look that AJ Drake has given his fallen opponent. And now what's he thinking? He's got a chair looking to perhaps end the career of his former... Oh, wait, hold on a second. And Sadio coming to the aid of his partner, grabbing that chair, getting Ben Castello out of harm's way, and at WrestleMania, it will be brother versus brother.
Try, time doesn't exist here, I will never die. I'm touching myself tonight.
Hold on a second, guys. I was just about to get ready for tonight's main event, but it looks as though we're going to be hearing from the man that was unsuccessful in gaining, or should I say, recapturing the Undisputed Championship back at Rumble of Riot 2. It is the Black Cat himself, Phil Bradshaw. I wasn't expecting Bradshaw to even be here tonight. I don't have him on my notes. But it is open fight night. Maybe Bradshaw's here to issue an open challenge. You gotta imagine he has plenty of thoughts on how the Rumble went down for him. Another just heartbreaking defeat for the man that once went by the name of the Living Legend. Yeah, right in his grasp, and he failed once again. This has just been another example of this just downward spiral that's been trending down and down for one of our most decorated talents here on ECF this season. Just cannot get over the hurdle of Jeff Garnett, the hurdle of falling just short at the finish line. Hold on a second, Bradshaw was looking to grab a mic, but who is this in the... That's Caius! Caius just came from the crowd, he's staring a hole through Phil Bradshaw. You want to talk about a man that's going through a crushing defeat? Hold on a second! Caius just dropped Phil Bradshaw. Come out here with a new look. Just drops Phil Bradshaw. I'm being told he calls that the Red Wedding. What was the meaning of that? Bradshaw clearly was about to say something. And Caius came out here and shut him up immediately, but Bradshaw is slowly getting to his feet. I just want to talk about the ECF Crossfire returns for our next installment, and it is going to be a jam-packed show. We're going to see the debut of the tag team of Ben Hopkins and John Blackos. We also know that Ryan Carroll, the big dog, will have a microphone in his hand. We know he's going to respond to Kevin Cross. It's going to be a great episode.
It's main event time. You should see me
in a crowd. Now it is time for our main event of the evening. The Texas Star versus the Elite One. And once again, here comes the Extreme Rumble winner and the number one contender for Jeff Garnett's Undisputed Championship. It is Stephen Jones. Ripley, I just want to rewind back to what we just saw from Caius, the Dark God coming out here with some new gear and just lays out Phil Bradshaw. Both men clearly frustrated, both men losing big title matches. In Caius's case, two back-to-back title matches. These are two men that are clearly frustrated, and they're clearly now looking to take it out on each other. But Phil Bradshaw is not a forgiving man. So if I were Caius, I would watch your back in the coming weeks, because this, I feel like it's just beginning. But Stephen Jones, coming off of a loss, if you go back to ECF Homecoming, we saw the reunion of the Rebel Republic, him and Chris Simmons, their old tag team. They were unsuccessful in defeating Rush Hour, although Stephen Jones not involved in the closing moments of that matchup. Jeff Garnett came out from backstage, and those two ended up brawling to the back. And when you say the name Jeff Garnett lately, it usually gets followed up by this man, his right-hand man, the other half of the gold standards of ECF, Matt Black, the current AWF Junior Heavyweight Champion, the current ECW NXT Champion. The list goes on and on of how Matt Black is just dominating this industry. They don't call him the Elite One for nothing. And Matt Black is looking to take out the Texas Star and end his road to WrestleMania prematurely here in Philadelphia for a return episode of Death Row.
you want to talk about Matt Black going up against former members of Headhunters, we saw that a few short months ago when he took on David Sandman. It was a losing effort for the Elite One that night. But to get a big win over another one of JG's former allies in Steven Jones will be huge for Camp Garnett going into WrestleMania. Also don't know, this is a good start for Matt Black, just to ground and pound strikes and try to stabilize, try to neutralize Steven Jones, I should say. Beautiful drop kick there. But the path for Matt Black right now to WrestleMania isn't particularly clear. We gotta assume he's gonna be in the corner of his running buddy, JG. But aside from that, you know, where else is he going to end up? Is he going to pursue a title of his own? Hell, if he beats Steven Jones tonight, is he going to claim that he is the rightful number one contender and will get a gold standard title match? Matt Black now going for the pin. Only getting a one count. Even going to have to do a bit more to take out a man of Jones's caliber. Matt has suffered very few defeats in singles action here in the ECF, in, at least in our YouTube era. Former Intercontinental Champion, World Champion back in the day. But now Steven Jones looking to reach that promised land once again. Confidence of the Texas Stomp. Big dropkick to the back of the head. Now Jones has him back up and drops him with that modified gut buster. Jones definitely has the height advantage. He's, I believe, standing at 6'4". Matt Black just pushing 6 feet. Big back elbow there from Matt Black, and now he's on the second rope. And another elbow, this time to the back of the neck of hashtag Texas Strong Steven Jones. And now Matt Black has him up. What's he thinking here? Looking for an air raid crash into the neck breaker. Very impressive move there by Matt Black. And now he's calling Jones back up, and he's got him dropped. And he's got the Koji clutch locked in. They're trying to get the submission victory here on Steven Jones. He's caught in the submission hole, but Jones able to escape it as this matchup continues. Reminder that this is our main event of the evening. It's been a great return episode for Death Row, our final open fight night of the season. We've had a great run this season. A lot of great moments here on open fight night this season. Jones now schoolboy into the big roundhouse kick. Forearm smash in the corner by Jones. Again, going for that modified gut buster. Now, Black rolling out of the ring, but Steven Jones still gonna fly a big crossbody to the outside. Matt Black, I don't think he saw that one coming. Jones again, going for the old bag of tricks there. Referee now at a count of four. Matt Black still not on his feet just yet. Right, trying to get back in the ring before. Hold on a second. Here we go. Oh, springboard knee right to the face of Steven Jones. And now Matt Black going up to the top. And oh my goodness! Spiral tap. And he just went from one side of the ring to the other, but that's just not enough to end this one. How impressive was that spiral tap? You know, I'm not a huge fan of Matt Black and his actions, but I gotta admit that this man can get it done in the ring, and this might be it. Kill switch! Are we seeing the end here for Steven Jones? But he's still got some life in him. Able to kick out of the kill switch. Matt Black now getting in the face of the referee. He's claiming that was three. But now trying to not get his eye off the ball for that long. Going back to Stephen Jones. And oof, just big stomp to the face there. Can't imagine. What implications would it have if Matt Black is able to put away Jones here? Do we see the dynamic of the title scene change? I mean, who knows? Just have to wait and see, I guess. And Jones, sunset flip into the pin. Here we go. Could this be enough? But no, Matt Black able to get the shoulder up at two. And this one continues. Now Jones, big float over neck breaker. I know Stephen Jones looking to fly. What does he have in store here? Oh dear God, picture perfect moonsault by the Texas Star. And this could be enough, but not just yet. This main event continues on here on Death Row. If Jones is able to go for that kill shot spear or perhaps that toss powerbomb, he would be able to put away Matt Black. But Matt Black, as we know, has several tricks up his sleeve that could get him closer to the victory. Jones taking some time to showboat. Maybe not the greatest idea, but I just mentioned the kill shot. We could be witnessing that right now. Goes for the kill shot, but Matt Black moves out of the way. And this could be the death nail for Stephen Jones himself. Matt Black going to the top rope. What is he thinking here? Beautiful corkscrew moonsault. This could be it. No! I thought that was three. But Matt Black again. Looks like he might be thinking for round two. Here we go, kill switch engaged. And Matt Black could be looking to change the landscape of this company, but no, again. Not enough to take out the Texas Star. Matt Black is throwing everything at Stephen Jones right now. Went for the leg drop, but the referee got in Matt Black's way. This could be bad news. Matt Black with the enziguri. Trying to wake the referee up. Continuing to go back into his attack. Big jawbreaker there. Now the referee slowly getting back to his feet. He went for that springboard leg drop, but the referee got caught in the crossfire. No pun intended. Now Stephen Jones would look to take advantage. And what is he thinking here? Joe going for the fisherman, swinging fisherman suplex. Perhaps a shot at Matt Black. We know Matt Black likes to go for a very similar move. Now Stephen Jones, here we go. He's calling for it. Here we go. Kick shot! And this could be it right here. And it is. Stephen Jones in a very hard-fought match. It was not easy. But he comes away with a big victory tonight over the Elite One. You gotta imagine Garnet is watching very, very closely at the result of this matchup. No, it wasn't an easy victory. He's got the battle scars to prove it, the crimson mask on his face. But the kill shot spear was enough to take the Elite One down for the three count. Great main event for our return episode of ECF Death Row. Now Matt Black is back in the ring. Jones still celebrating. Going to check in on his opponent, the sportsmanship of Jones, but oh no! Cheap shot there by Matt Black. Clearly not happy with the result of this matchup. And oh no, there he is. The champ is here. And look at him taking credit for Matt Black's dirty work. And now he's signaling Matt Black to go under the ring. Oh no, and he's got a steel chair. This is not good. This is not good for Stephen Jones.
Garnett's got that chair in hand. Now he's threatening the referee. This is just disgusting. No, dear God, no! Garnett now continuing this beatdown with the steel chair. Matlock saying, give me a go. I want a piece of this action. And now Matt Black now with the assault with the steel chair. And this alliance between Garnett and Black has just been dominant since forming. Taking Steven Jones out with a steel chair. And now Garnett is alone in the ring with his WrestleMania opponent, looking to put the finishing touches on his beatdown. But Steven Jones back on his feet. And he's got Garnett up. And he drops him with the toss powerbomb. Steven Jones getting the last laugh. They brought their chairs, but it wasn't enough to keep the Texas Star down. And we could have just seen a sneak preview of WrestleMania 2 in Los Angeles. What a great return episode we had for Death Row here tonight. I'm Jared Extreme, and we will see you next time for the return of ECF Crossfire.